for the very last time before Christmas. Oh, I'm hoping you'll join us on Christmas morning. It's the Mighty Van coming around Van Friday each and every week with 1, 2, 3 tip-top Freeview film recommendations to get you through the weekend. It's the festive weekend, of course. Loads of film choices. He gives you 3. I'll give you 3 as well, and we kind of meet you in the middle. Good morning, Van, and a very, very Merry Christmas indeed, to you, sir. And a huge thanks for what you've helped us out with this. You've been fantastic on the show. Always get great feedback. And you've got 3, what a surprise, Christmas-themed movies for us for the weekend. Where would you like to start, Van? Good morning.
I mean, they're accident. Good morning, by the way, Paul. Yeah, they're kind of accidentally Christmas themed. They just happen. You know, I always pick the one that's on that I would want to watch again.
Yeah.
Because I've seen more or less everything. So going through Freeview for me is just, which one of these would I genuinely want to see and enjoy again? It just so happens that 2 out of the 3 over the Christmas period have happened to be Christmas movies. So fair enough. I'll just roll with it.
Okie dokie. And you're going for, well, maybe it's an homage to the Mighty Wham song, Last Christmas. Tell us about that. Why that one in particular, Ben?
This is one. This came out just before the pandemic. So this was Christmas, like 3 months before the pandemic. It was directed by Paul Feig, who did Bridesmaids, but it was written by Emma Thompson. And it stars Emilia Clarke and Henry Golding. And Emilia Clarke is this cynical, nasty, deadpan, self-involved Christmas store employee who seems to have no time for Christmas, who, you know, meets this mysterious stranger played by Henry Golding, you know, the dreamy Henry Golding, who's the most perfect man in the universe and starts to bring like nice qualities out of her. And, you know, he seems almost too good to be true. Reminder, this is a rom-com that's, you know, written by Emma Thompson. So, of course, this is all going to be, you know, too good to be true. I'll give you a clip. This is on BBC One tonight at 11:15. I will get to why. I'll explain why after. You kind of need to hear it first. This is the couple interacting early on in meeting.
I mean, most where we can catch this one today.
BBC One at 11:15 tonight.
Okay, it's the Last Christmas. It sounds delightful. Here's the clip.
Is that really a good nutritional choice?
Oh, God, don't you stop.
Where are you?
Look up.
Yeah.
You know, after what you've been through, I mean, shouldn't you be eating quinoa or kale or something?
Yeah, but this admittedly rank burger is all part of my grand plan to become a famous singer and die like Kurt Cobain, Amy Winehouse and all the rest at the age of 27.
How old are you?
45.
Oh, good to have dreams.
Not really, I'm 26.
Well, thank God. You still have time. Come on.
Where?
Get rid of that.
Wait.
Let's go.
I've got a surprise for you.
I've not seen this from Mossack. It sounds quite charming. So that's a goodie from the sound of it.
And that, cheesy.
Even in there, cheesy, but a few laughs built in along the way. Nice kind of comfort watch for Cribbo. Now, I've gone for something rather different. It's the opposite of a comfort watch. It was the Coen brothers' breakthrough film back in unbelievably renowned 1984.
I know.
It kind of created... People talked about 80s noir now, and I think this was probably one of the kickstarters, along with other very cold films like American Gigolo and things around at the same time. And basically, it's a very simple plot. Bartender's having an affair with the... wife of his boss. The boss suspects the wife's having an affair, so he hires this greasy, hideous, he's watching overweight roadkill functioning as a hitman. M.M. Walsh plays him. It's a brilliant film in that sense. You get a real sense of kind of gritty urban life and then rural life in Texas. You get some great characters in it, a great soundtrack, and basically it is a rather brutal, full-on and bloody murder mystery. And the title, Blood Simple, don't know if you know this, sir, Van, comes from a Dashiell Hammett novel from 1929, I think called Red Harvest. And he said that when kind of ordinary law-abiding folk get caught up in the whirlwind of passion and murder, they become what he calls blood simple. They don't think straight. And I didn't know that until recently. It's a great quote, though, isn't it? For them, it's very Coen brothers to dig that out, isn't it? I think this is actually, even though it's their first film, it's probably my favourite film of theirs, along with possibly Raising Arizona. I mean, they've had some great movies as well, but this is as a calling card to Hollywood, this is an immense film, I think, and a very important film, I think, in its own way.
Yeah, well, I mean, say, as a calling card, this is one of those, like, wow, okay. But to be fair, the Coen brothers as talents are still genuinely, okay, wow, that same reaction. They seem to exist in this pocket dimension of talent entirely unto their own, because you can't look at a movie that they have made and not immediately go, that's a Coen brothers movie.
Absolutely.
You know their tone, you know their style, you know their sensibilities, and Wes Anderson kind of has the same auteur-like quality. They are, you know, as close as we have to sort of the modern auteurs in that traditional sense, but definitely this is a watershed movie. It's a great movie anyway, but it's definitely a watershed movie and a great calling card one, as you say.
So it's 11 o'clock, it's tonight. At the very least, record it, folks, and do yourselves a favour. The soundtrack is immense, bit of Motown stirred into the mix as well, and we've got Blood Simple, 11 o'clock tonight, film 4. Here's a burst of the 90s trailer.
The world is full of complainers. The fact is, nothing comes with a guarantee. Something can all go wrong.
Hello.
You having a good time?
Who is it?
Your husband.
The more I think about it, the more irritated I get. I got a job for you.
If pay's right and it's legal, I'll do it.
It's not strictly legal.
Pay's right. I do. You want me to kill him?
Hold it.
He certainly does want him to kill him, and things sometimes, you know, the best laid plans of mice, men and murderers oft gang agley, as Robbie Burns said. So that's my first recommendation. And now you're going full on Father Christmas, an 80s-tastic film. I think this may have been, if it didn't perform wonderfully at the box office, if memory serves. I know it's got Dudley Moore in it, amongst others. Santa Claus, the movie. Tell us why you picked this one, Matt, as if I can vaguely work out it's kind of Santa Claus and it's Christmas Day. Is it those two things connected at all?
Well, I mean, it's going to be on Christmas Eve. You know, it's tomorrow night on Christmas Eve.
Of course it's tomorrow.
But the thing with this one is I have a weird soft spot for this. I never saw this as a child. And I only saw this when I was in my early 20s, when I was with a girlfriend and discovered that this was, watching this movie was one of her Christmas traditions. So I saw it for the first time. And I was blown away by the discovery that after having made Superman 3 and Supergirl, the Solkinds then decided to apply the exact same formula of filmmaking that they've been using to the actual legend of Santa Claus. And what you actually get out of this is effectively Batman Begins for Santa, but made by the Solkinds in the exact tone and style of specifically Superman 3 and Supergirl. It stars David Huddleston as Santa in the literal Santa origin story that then leaps forward in time. And in the same way Batman Begins goes from the origin story to then doing the whole, you know, Liam Neeson plot at the end for the third act, this goes from the origin story to Santa having to take on a corrupt toy maker played by none other than John Lithgow, so automatic seal of approval there, in this sort of attempt to flood the market with a dangerous toy that happens to have been designed by Santa's jaded chief elf, played by Dudley Moore. This thing is nuts. I absolutely love it. It's on ITV tomorrow at 2:35 in the afternoon. Oh my God, I am watching this. I haven't seen it in ages. It's awesome.
Now, I queued unbelievably outside the old Marble Arch Odeon, which I think is now gone at the tail end of Oxford Street, with my son James, who would have been not much more than 4 or 5 when this came out. And I remember at the time thinking, that's 2 hours of my life I'll never get it back. But maybe it was kind of by the fact I had to queue. And also, it was the only thing, I mean, I'm going to watch it again. Or maybe we saw it again, because if I remember right, it kind of turned up just before special effects took an exponential leap up. So it's still like the back end of the Superman type special effects. And it's not quite as convincing as they became afterwards. So as a little bit of a document of cinematic history, it's okay. If you're a fan of the young ones, okay, and I remember this. I can't remember the actor's name, but the actor who played Mike the Cool One in The Young Ones, the part that was meant to be for Ben Elton, he was persuaded not to play the Cool One, he wouldn't be more of a writer. Because I think they hired every short, dark-haired actor in Equity or in America to be elves in this one. It's a big cast in this, and Mike the Cool One turns up with a few lines as well. So there we go for Young One fans. And you've got a clip for us, I understand, of Santa Claus the movie.
I have indeed. This is Dudley Moore as the elf Patch and his interactions with the devious toy maker who has seduced him into capitalistic, you know, corporate life, played by John Lithgow. You can hear them scheming away here.
Okay, that's ITV tomorrow afternoon. Is that right? Christmas Eve afternoon?
Christmas Eve at 2:35 in the afternoon. It's a perfect one to whittle away the afternoon to.
It's Santa Claus the movie.
How many workers does this product require?
Just me.
No payroll?
Well, my needs are simple. A bowl of stew, heavy on the dill, a cold place to sleep.
What would it cost?
Cost? Cost who?
The people who buy the toy.
Well, nothing. We're going to give them away free.
Oh, that's fantastic. How do you turn your face so red so fast?
For free!
Well, that's how we do it at the North Pole.
Well, that's not how we do it here! In a free enterprise system!
On the other hand, this would go a long way towards cleaning up my public image.
Excuse me?
Oh, it's not a bad investment.
I'd forgotten John Lithgow was in it, and maybe I've completely misjudged this film because of my, you know, frostbite I got waiting outside to get in there. So I'll be watching that one for you. And I've got my second recommendation now. It tips just over into Christmas morning, but it's 1 o'clock on in the morning, Christmas morning. It's effectively maybe the film you see just before you decide to toddle up the wooden hills to Bedfordshire, or maybe record it. It's from 2016. It got 14 Oscar nominations, won 6 of them, cost about $30 million, made almost $500 million, directed by Damien Chazelle, who also, been responsible for that great film, Whiplash, which starred J.K. Simmons. It pops up in this briefly. It's Ryan Gosling. It's Emma Stone. It's a musical. I think it's a magical film, but it's very Marmite, this film here. I mean, my producer, Sam Stevens, isn't on duty this morning. He's away for Crimbo. He loves musicals. He didn't like this film. And I can't quite work out why, except that maybe it's a kind, I mean, there's an element of fantasy. It's also quite cinema referential. I always think there's echoes in this film of Mulholland Drive, for example, the mad David Lynch film about Hollywood and Los Angeles. I mean, I absolutely loved it. You know, Ryan Gosling proves he can tap dance a bit. It reminds us he came first of all from the Mickey Mouse Club, along with Britney Spears, and I think, who else was in the...
Christina Aguilera?
Aguilera, of course, was there, yeah. So did you enjoy this one at the time, or were you also a bit indifferent to it?
No, I quite enjoyed this at the time. I've actually gone the other way on La La Land. I like it less as time goes by. I liked it when it came out, though, but I just think that it's worn off. Its charm has worn away on me quite quickly. And I think, to be honest, a big part of that is the seeming ever presence of Damien Chazelle now, because he's just like a staple of award season.
And I think it's got a great soundtrack as well, some lovely songs in it, some of which you know the tunes of, even if you've not seen the film. So try and catch this one as well, folks. A nice musical, very early beginning to Christmas Day, the tail end of Christmas Eve. BBC One, 1 a.m. on Sunday morning. It counts as a Saturday show, though. It's La La Land from 2016, and here's a burst of the trailer.
It's pretty strange that we keep running into each other.
Maybe it means something.
I doubt it.
Yeah, I don't think so. You could just write your own roles, you know, write something that's as interesting as you are.
What are you going to do?
I have my own club.
Is that going to happen every time?
I think so.
How are you going to be a revolutionary if you're such a traditionalist? You're holding on to the past, but jazz is about the future.
Maybe I'm not good enough.
Yes, you are.
Maybe I'm not. It's like a pipe dream.
This is the dream. It's conflict and it's compromise. It's very, very exciting.
And I should have said, as well as being a love story, it's also a kind of love song, if you like, a love film to Hollywood. Basically, an aspiring actress played by Emma Stone, who won the Oscar. It's about to give up. Ryan Gosling is a jazz musician, but he's totally frustrated by John Legend's in it as well, of course. He plays like his mentor or the advisor, saying, look, you know, get with the program. You can't constantly hark back to the old days. You can't constantly go back to Oscar Peterson. Let's have some new jazz. So it's also, in its own way, a bit of a heartbreaking film as well, if you fancy shedding a tear over Crimbo. So that's my second recommendation. Now, when I heard about my third recommendation, which is on Christmas evening, 10:55 p.m., I thought, Steven Spielberg is remaking the film that John Borman directed for Dave Clark 5. Catch Me If You Can. Here We Come Again. Ooh. Catch us. No, not that at all. It's a story of a con man, Frank Abagnale, who may have conned people into believing his con tricks were true. Played by, of course, the Leonardo DiCaprio, looking absolutely fantastic as this kind of iconic 60s dude. And basically plays a high school student who realises people aren't checking up when you cash a check. People aren't checking your bona fides or your credentials if you say you're an airline pilot, for example. You've got confidence and swagger. Or if you say you're a doctor. Or if you say you're a lawyer. And at some point in his life, he claims to have played all three, successfully portrayed them as a con man. Christopher Walken's in this, having the time of his life as his dad, who's constantly in trouble with the tax authorities. Tom Hanks, I think, is also underrated in this film. He's brilliant as the FBI agent on this guy's trail, who's really got no life himself apart from chasing down the con man. In the end, they have this fantastic relationship. And it made a lot of money, I think, in 2002. Didn't seem to lead anywhere much, though, for Leonardo DiCaprio, as far as, I mean, I thought then this is it. He's now going to make this kind of, I don't know what he's, you know, okay, I think he made The Great Gatsby after this and played more to his suave side, but since then I think he's, well, what has made some interesting films, he's kind of tailed off a bit for me. I think this is a great movie, this one. It's one of those kind of a whirling dervish of a film. Once I start watching this, I simply can't stop.
No, I actually think this had more of an influence on DiCaprio than you think, because I actually think that Catch Me If You Can is kind of the fertile training ground that then leads him to be able to do The Wolf of Wall Street, like 15 years later. Yeah. Like, because there's the seeds there. You get the sort of the hint in this that he could do something down the line as absolutely unhinged as The Wolf of Wall Street. There's the setup here.
And also, there's wonderful moments in it when, for example, he's thinking about masquerading as a doctor, and he watches an old medical film, and they use the word concur, yeah. And he uses that with, and he's training other students, even though he's younger than some of them. They all swallow, or seem to, hook, line, and sinker. So it's on 10:55 p.m. on Channel 4. That's Christmas night, of course. It's Catch Me If You Can. And there's a bijou burstet of the trailer.
This is irrefutable evidence that the defendant is lying.
Special Agent Hanratty, FBI.
Hello, Carl.
You're gonna get caught. It's like Vegas. The house always wins.
Some nuts flying around the country posing as a pilot.
Call him the James Bond of the sky.
Hello, pusher.
This is by far the best date I have ever been on.
He's a kid. That's why he doesn't have a record.
30 milligrams of codeine every 4 hours. Do you concur?
I concur.
Dr. Harris.
Yes?
Do you concur?
Concur with what, sir?
Ma'am, I'm sorry to have to tell you, your son has fudged your checks.
I have a payroll check here and like the cash.
I'm working part-time at the church now. Just tell me how much yours and I'll pay you back.
$1.3 million.
I'll be choosing 8 young ladies to be a part of Pan Am's future stewardess program.
South America, Australia, Singapore. These are so perfect, the bankers even know the difference. What do you want?
To apologize.
You didn't call to apologize, did you? You have no one else to call.
Great feel that is. So that's on at 10:55 p.m. 5 to 11 in the old money. Christmas night itself, of course, on Channel 4. And you're ending with, well, we might have a trailer for this one, won't we? Because it's actually pretty much a silent film you've chosen for Christmas Day. Tell us more about it. It's Shaun the Sheep, though, isn't it? So we forgive an awful lot for that.
We do. It's weird to consider that, you know, these are like quite popular, you know, popcorn pleasing animated movies, and yet they are silent movies. We kind of don't think about it. We can't really provide a clip for a Shaun the Sheep movie because it's all gestures and noises. Amazing. Yeah, exactly.
I'm in there, though.
So this is the standalone sequel from 2019. I think the first Shaun the Sheep movie done in about 2015. And this is a standalone sequel in which you get the various Shaun the Sheep Aardman animated farmyard characters having to basically reenact the plot of E.T. With an alien life form that crashes and is then being hunted by the Ministry for Alien Detection, I think they're called, because it abbreviates to MAD. And you get the Men in Black types, you know, descending upon, you know, Shaun's farm to try and find this alien creature. So you basically get the plot of E.T. by Aardman. It's a brilliant directorial debut from, I think it's Richard Phelan and Will Belcher. It's their first actual features. And it's just rife with all of these great classic sci-fi in-jokes and nods and winks and things like that. You'll love this, Paul. There's 1,000 nods to like old Heston movies and The Day the Earth Stood Still and things like that. But they're in a child-friendly Aardman movie. It's just brilliant.
Brilliant stuff. Okay, so when can we see this one? It's a Christmas Day afternoon, I'm presuming.
Yep, this is 1 o'clock in the afternoon on Christmas Day. It's the perfect sort of, you know, veg after your lunch kind of thing.
And there are so many movies around at the moment. Can we prevail upon you to join us Christmas morning? I'm on from midnight till 4 a.m, Ben. So it might mean getting up or waiting up until before Santa's arrived, then very quickly going to bed in your wee willy winky nightgown and cap.
Well, I've seen Violent Night, so I'm not going to sleep on Christmas Eve anymore. No, I'm never. I'm staying up all Christmas Eve and into Christmas morning every night forever now, thanks to Violent Night. So I will definitely keep you company, Paul.
Marvellous stuff. We'll do some more Christmas recommendations then on Sunday morning, the wee small hours of Christmas morning with me, Paul Ross, and Van Collin. Meanwhile, well, I've realised now that all three of the movies I've chosen have got great soundtracks. Blood Simple certainly has. Motown classic in there from the Four Tops. Of course, La La Land is by definition a musical, also great sounds. And also, Catch Me If You Can reminded me of that brilliant Bobby Darin version of the song, first sung by Barbara Streisand in Funny Girl. We might end with a burst of that. Don't rain on my parade. Van Connor never does. He's back with the Christmas morning. It's Merry Christmas from me and from Van. And over to you, the wonderful Bobby Darin.